Hi, this is Paul Solt from iPhone Dev TV. This is going to be our first Q&A video. I shot this once already and I messed up the focus so it looked really strange. Hopefully this is going to come in a little bit better. And I just want to go over some of the questions that I've been receiving for this course just from today's questions. So the first one is, where can you find solutions to different things? And the answer is on the forum. I've set up a solutions category and you can just take a look at that. In that category, you're going to have each daily topic and then other people can respond or I might respond if no one is solving the problem. So that's the best place to start there. Next, subtitles are going to be delayed a little bit. So I can't get subtitles right now, same day. It's going to take 1 to 3 days to get them transcribed from the videos and then back onto the website. So that's sort of the turnaround time I'm looking at. If you really need subtitles and you want to learn with them, I'm going to really recommend that you wait a week or so before you get started with the course materials. And if you're not going at the pace that we're going to be going at, you'll be fine just starting now and just working with it, because I will be adding subtitles on a daily basis as we are generating them. Another question is, should I own a Mac? I highly recommend it. If you don't have a Mac, everything that you're going to do in this course is going to be a little bit slower. It's still possible. You can save money using something like Mac and Cloud, which is a $20 a month service. It is slower, so if performance is a big thing for you, you might want to consider borrowing a friend's Mac to get started. And another question is that I've gotten a few times is, how do I get started? I'm a Kickstarter backer. Well, if you're watching this, there's a nice little tutorial I put on the forum for Kickstarter backers on how to redeem the rewards, and I pinned it to the top. So the thing that you'll need to do is just look through your Kickstarter messages, and that is a little bit confusing if you don't fully understand the Kickstarter website. It is hidden. You have to click on your icon in the top right corner, and then there's a messages thing. And then once you do that, search for a message with me, and then it sometimes hides like the most recent message, or if I send two messages at the same time and you haven't read both, you'll only see the newest one. So then you lose out on some of them. So I've sent messages with all the links, and you can get started if you just find the links. Now, in terms of being overwhelmed, Daniel pointed out that he was a little bit worried about the outline of the course materials. And there are a lot of topics, but my goal is to try to make this approachable to you. So that's going to be sort of a two-way street. I need to know if the content that I'm creating for you is really helping you understand the material or if I'm confusing you too much. Now, I am going to sort of take my own perspective and apply it to you. So that means that sometimes I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to throw a lot of code out there. I'm going to see what sticks. You might not understand everything, and that's sort of the point. I want to give you an overview of programming iPhone apps, but I want to give you a more realistic expectation of how the process works, what it's going to look like before we start learning all of the components. Because I find that when I don't get to fiddle with things and I don't get to play with things, it's hard for me to understand why I'm learning certain topics. Kyle asked, do I recommend Objective-C first? I would say no. I think if you want to make iPhone apps, Swift is a great language to start with. It's got a lot of potential. It is new, but there are things that make Swift a lot easier to write code in. It's more approachable than Objective-C just because of the syntax. The square braces in the message calling in Objective-C is a huge turnoff for experienced developers to Objective-C. It makes it harder for some reason for them, and it increases the barrier to entry. So I think Swift is approachable. I would start there. That's what these lessons are about. And I think you'll get the most bang for your buck there. Now, if you want to get into open source code projects, learning Objective-C is really important because you're going to have to work with Objective-C projects. But that doesn't need to be the first thing that you learn. And I would say I'm not of the opinion that you need to learn some other language to learn what you really want to learn. If you really want to learn something, you can go out there and you can learn it. You don't need handholding to get through it. It's something that if you put your mind to it, you will be able to learn. Next up, a question was asked about why I manually created the labels in the first daily lesson. And the reason I did that is because I want to sort of unveil the magic behind iPhone apps. There's a lot of stuff you get for free when you use the user interface and you sort of just drag and drop things. And by learning about the position, the size, and whether something's visible or not, or if it's on screen or off screen, or if it's animating, these types of things are really important. So getting some exposure to that now is going to help you understand why we need to learn some of the upcoming topics, which include a deeper look into variables, into loops, into all kinds of things that relate to iPhone apps. And I use a little bit of both. I use both code and user interface designer when I'm making my apps. So being comfortable with both is really important. And if you are going to be doing these dynamic interfaces, it's really important to understand the code side because there's so much power that you get out of that. Another question was about, and this was a long one, why you need self in the animate block. And so there's this code block that's the UI view animate with duration. And this is where we added the spring animation, which is the physics-based animation. And we had to do self in here. If you don't do that, you get this Swift compiler error. That compiler error says that the reference to the property iPhone label or whichever one you were in the closure requires explicit self to make a capture semantics explicit. So it's this sort of limitation based on the compiler wanting you to write it a certain way. And that's why we have to write it there. We can write that through the rest of the application, but one of the features of Swift is that they make it so that you don't always have to write all of the boilerplate code. So you can reduce the amount of code you can write. And so we can actually drop self from a lot of other places that we'd normally have to write it in Objective-C. So when you're looking at this, it's related to the implementation details of how these open-ended functions work. And these are called closures or blocks from Objective-C. And these are functions that can be named or unnamed. And it's essentially a block of code that can do some work. And in order for that to work properly, there's a memory aspect to it. And we'll get more into how memory works later on in the course. But the gist is the computer needs to know what information is current and what information is alive. There's sort of lifetimes for different objects in your program. You're going to be freeing up space and taking space to represent pictures or photo albums or even just user data in your application. So that sort of touches upon the self thing. And self, when you hear the word in Objective-C or in Swift, it means the current instance. And when I say instance, I want you to think of an example involving blueprints and buildings. You want to think of instances as the actual building that's built. So I'm sitting in a building. This is the instance of a blueprint that was designed by someone else. And the same blueprint can be used to create multiple buildings, but each building is unique. Each building has different sets of businesses that work in them. There's different people in them. There's different rooms. There's different layouts. There's different temperatures, all kinds of different attributes associated with a particular building. So when we're talking about objects, we're talking about instances of these objects, and these are our digital representations of, it could be concrete information, it could be user data, anything that you want to represent to the computer to send to your app, to send to your server, that's the type of stuff that we'll be doing with objects. So that's it for the questions that I got today. And if you have any other questions for day two, just feel free to post them and I will look forward to answering them in a format very similar to this so that we can get the ball rolling. All right, so you guys have a great day and I'm gonna go get some sleep.